So let's start. Okay guys, before we start, let's have some class rules, or you can say the protocols of the class, very clear. So first of all, what I'm going to discuss on the board, I would like you to have a very close attention, don't miss classes, and try to take most of the key points as notes. Second thing is that in case you miss any class, these lectures will be always available on portals. You should watch it before you come to the next class. Third thing is like regarding the doubts. I know we will be having a lot of queries and questions when I'm going to teach you. So the thing is that don't worry, we'll take care of each of the questions being asked by each one of you. So if you have a question, we're going to have a doubt window. So when I say there is a doubt window, means we'll have a 5 to 10 minutes of time after every break and at the end of session. So there you can ask all these generic questions, generic type of doubts. Although having said that, if you have any question pertaining to the current topic or whatever diagram we are drawing here, and if you have a question pertaining to that, please ask that. Okay. So before we start communication system, let me chalk out what is the textbook that we should recommend, what is the gate weightage and all. So gate weightage is varying from 6 marks to sometimes I have seen question being asked for 10 marks. So it's a very, very important subject. It's a very key subject. Okay. My favorite textbook in this is Introduction to Analog and Digital Communication. And the author is Simon Hicking. Okay. So it is, you can say it is one of the very short book. Everybody reads this book. So idea is to go through my notes, okay? And if you have any doubts, let's say suppose you want more info, more resource, right? Go through the content. Just see, let's say for example, you want to study pulse code modulation. So already I have taught in the class, but at the same time, you need more information. You need to go through it. You need to cover it more. You can always open this textbook, right? And still, if you're not getting something, you can bring that question for the next session, which will be taking care here. So that is one of the textbooks that is complete. It covers analog communication, it covers digital communication. So there is that's a complete book. If somebody is like an avid reader, somebody who reads textbooks a lot, I doubt for that, but if you read a lot of books, the other book I would say is Digital Communication by author is Prokes. So he is also an excellent author, okay? He's also an excellent author, and I guess that you might have seen one of his books written is Digital Signal Processing in your own college exams, right? So he is a very good author and you can have a look. But my preference would be lying with this book. So this is the book you should refer at all point of time, okay? Now guys, what is the motivation of communication, right? And why people should be excited to study this subject? So I would take some time on this and we'll discuss that point. I will also try to discuss what is the myth around communication or what is the hype, right? So if you ask me what is communication and how old is this subject, so I can say that this subject dates back to centuries. Even when there was no devices, no electronic devices, chips, ICs, right, mobile phones, telephones, still people were communicating. if I take back to like Stone Age, not that far, but still. So you might seen people, might have seen in the movies, people trying to communicate by creating different kinds of sounds, like beating drums. So they were able to communicate. They were able to communicate by like burning some fire, a different kind of fire, and the smoke was a kind of communication. Later on, people started using birds, like you might have seen pigeons for the communication. And there is a famous Bollywood song on that. In Bahubali movie, you might have seen an eagle doing the communication, right? In the Bahubali, I think part 2, if you have seen the movie, you might have seen an eagle carrying the key information. Obviously, the eagle is not talking to the, in the people's language. So people used to tie a kind of, paper roll around the bird's feet, and the bird was trying to being the carrier for that part. So it dates back to century. Later on, telegraph came, and the people started using telegram. Morse code was there, and with the invention of ICs and transistors and ICs, people started doing communication or using communication like anything. But before that, don't forget the contribution of Marconi. Marconi was the person who invented radio. The first broadcast, you can say, happened when Marconi tested it, and that was, you can say, the the stepping stone for communication. Now people have come such a long way, right? People using birds to do that. Now people are using Skype, WhatsApp messages, video call, right? So you have to thank 2-3 people here. The first one I just said, Marconi. The second one is Fourier. So a lot of students might disagree that why Fourier? So my dear friends, Fourier is the person, or I would better say is like he was the amazing mathematician who gave you to look at the time domain signal, right, into the frequency domain. So for any communication devices, I'm going to highlight these two words so many times in that session, that bandwidth and power. So bandwidth and power, these are the two main parameters that you need to design any communication system. Okay, Fourier help you to understand what is the frequency component of any time domain signal. So mathematically, time domain signal was always there, but Fourier helped us to know what is the component in the frequency domain. And then we started understanding the concept of bandwidth, and later on it became our spectrum. And using certain kinds of filter, we were able to understand that if you want this much this signal from this frequency range, you can apply a band pass filter. Okay, so guys, power we'll talk about later, but let me bust the myth around communication. A lot of people would say that communication system is a very difficult subject, and it's like impossible to understand this or crack this subject in GATE. I completely disagree. Only those students who would say this, that set of people are not good in certain basic subject. So for example, if you're not good in maths, right, you're going to have little difficulty in communication system. If you're not good in signals and system, you will definitely have difficulty in understanding communication system. And the third one is probability and random variable. So rather than focusing on, the rumors, or you can say that these talks that let's leave that subject out, I would say that the moment you leave communication system out of the GATE syllabus, you are half an engineer. So if I say what is our branch is electronics and communication, or let's say instrumentation guys, right? So for any of these engineers, if they are not good in communication system, which is an integrated subject of so many different subjects, right? So you are not making a sense being an engineer. So my idea is to work out on these basic subjects. If you are weak in that, if you are weak in signal system, start working on it, and you can always build from there. And anyway, I'm going to tell you all those basic thing, even the what is the Fourier transform of delta t, what is the Fourier transform of a DC signal, what is the Fourier transform of unit step signal. So I will take care of these, whatever the thing that is being required in this subject. At the same time, my request to you guys is that please take care of these prerequisites. So let me write it down for you so that you don't miss. Engineering maths, second one, signals and systems, and the third one is probability and random variables. Now guys, in signal system you can actually start at directly Fourier transform. This is what we are going to need, continuous Fourier transform. So you can just ignore now for all those other topics, but you should start with Fourier transform. Probability and random variable will be needing in digital communication. So we are going to need this in digital communication. So for now, you should start with engineering maths. You should revise, quickly brush it off, okay? Now guys, the other thing that we should be very much strict about, let's say you studied certain topics today, okay? And if you study this topic and you don't revise, then it will be a big problem. So my sincere request to you guys is, suppose I have taught, let's say today, amplitude modulation. The first thing you will do that quickly make notes and revise your notes. And then the second step should be solve gate questions. So anyway, I will be taking a very good number of gate questions. When I say very good number of gates, I will be doing sufficient gate questions. I have my own set of modules handpicked by me, and I will take care of those questions. I will also tell you though, wow, this question is making sense and how many times they are being asked. I will also say that in the class that what is the weightage of a certain topic in that whole session. So don't worry about that. And let's say, for example, if I would say amplitude modulation, what is the importance of this topic in gate, right? But at the same time, my request to you guys to not pinpoint or focus only on the weightage of gate and basis that you understand this subject, understand this topic. Let's say, for example, I do one topic which is not going to being asked in gate, but that without that topic you cannot understand the next subject. You are getting my point. So let's focus on each of these topics for now, and slowly we'll understand that how frequently they are being asked in gate, right? And we'll also see that what is the weightage, correct? Now let me give you the motivation about this subject. So if I ask you, right, have you ever seen everybody has seen TV, right? So if you recall your old days, there used to be only one channel, correct? And we call, I think DD1, right? Doordarshan. So DD1 used to be the first channel that everybody must have seen in their childhood days. And if somebody was like born yesterday, right, they might have a good array of channels. But my idea is not to take you back, right? My idea is not to take you back. My idea is to make you understand. Now we have 100 plus channels, correct? So if I ask you this question, what is happening when you switch from channel 105 to 203? What is happening from communication system point of view? Just ping your answers. It is known as frequency division multiplexing. It's multiplexing, guys. Frequency division multiplexing. So obviously when we go in this topic, we'll study in full detail, there's no problem. But let me give a very quick overview. Frequency division multiplexing is what? Like, you want to have 100 signals, different signals, and that's why we have different channels, right? In the same spectrum, you are going to put, right, those signals. Let's say this is our spectrum. So you're going to put one signal here with certain guard band. You'll put another signal here with a certain guard band, and you'll put another signal here. So let's say this is signal 1, signal 2, signal 3. So I'm just giving a very rough idea. Okay? So this is known as frequency division multiplexing. But we'll go in detail. Okay, let me bring you another incident that you might have observed once in a life. Right? Let me know, yes, when you have seen this sometime in your around you. So have you ever seen any person recording a video of the TV? So you put a camera on the TV screen and TV already is playing some movie song or something. When you're trying to record that, you see some horizontal lines are coming from top to bottom. Have you ever observed, or somebody has ever observed that, like lines appear? Yes. So anyone knows what is the reason? Okay, let me put you in another example. Have you guys ever observed, right, when you are looking at a fan which is revolving at a very high speed, you know, when the fan is revolving at a very fast speed, let's say the knob to 5, right? So that fan is at max speed. Have you ever observed that to you, fan looks that it is moving in opposite direction slowly? Have you ever seen that? Answer to these two examples is sampling theorem. Okay, so you might be thinking, sir, how is the relation with sampling theorem? That's why you have to stay tuned to this class, right? When the time is right, I will tell you that what is the answer to these type of questions. And that's how you get motivated to learn this subject, because this is not a subject, it is a subject of all the subject. So you might think that it is like mother of all the subject, because you have studied analog integrated circuits, right? Where we are going to use, you will be seeing the application along integrated circuit, like anything in communication system. You have studied signal sense system, you are going to use that subject in this communication system. So whenever I'm going to design any block diagram, let's say for amplitude modulation or frequency modulation, it is going to use different building blocks from different subject, right? And that's how the beauty of this subject is so amazing, that you are not only understanding one subject at a time, you are going to study 2-3 different subjects at the same time. It might feel a little tough in the beginning, but be motivated about this. Don't give up. That's my sincere request. And I will make sure that you understand every bit what I'm trying to say. Okay, so that's how you're going to get the answer. Just for the TV part, let me tell you the quick answer for that. TV transmits the video at a different sampling rate than the sampling rate of the video camera, that handycam, right? So that's why there's a difference of sampling rate, and that's why it goes out of sync and that lines come. And similarly, the answer for the, you know, the fan thing, fan actually revolves so fast, but our eyes, which is like taking the, you know, images, our eyes have a certain speed. It can only senses 24 pictures in 1 second. That's how our eyes can take it out. If anything is going more than that, then lag start creating. And that is because of that lag, the fan looks to us that it is going slowly in the opposite direction. Because the moment you are trying to capture the whole revolvement, right, till then the other circles are coming, right? And your eyes are not able to access that information that fast. So that is the reason that the fans which goes in the, you know, let's say clockwise direction, to your eyes it will look anti-clockwise direction, but with a very slow speed, because that's how our eyes can sample it. Okay? Let's answer this question, that what is communication system? Okay, so what is the communication system? If you want to answer this question, so I know in any college it is being taught that you can transmit the information from one place to another, that is communication, and that's correct, right? We are doing whatever we are doing in the classroom, what we are doing as of now, that is also communication. And I will take this as an example to, you know, make you understand that this classroom session where I'm using a mic to talk to you guys, you're looking at me with the help of a camera, right? Just try to visualize that you see a lot of communication system around you all the day, right? And then we are trying to understand that, okay, what is happening inside? And that is where I'm going to picture in, right? And that is where I'm going to come in and try to make you understand. So let's understand what is communication system. So, right, in this, it is defined as the transfer of some information from one place and let's call it as source from one place to another place, and this is our destination. If you ask me that what we can call it in, you know, communication language, then it will be called as transmitter to receiver. Okay? With the help of some systems. With the help of some system. So what is communication system? We are using certain system, right, in a desired manner, so that we can communicate some information. So, you know, I hope you understand what is the difference between information and noise. Information is desirable, noise is undesirable, right? Information is something which has meaningful value, content in that, right? So if you are transferring some information from one place to another with the help of some system, we call it as communication system. Now that system will depend totally on the mode of communication. If you are using analog communication, right, and that too in amplitude modulation, we are going to use amplitude modulator, right? If you are using double sideband, you are going to use a balanced modulator. So what are these different blocks? Slowly we'll go in deep. We'll try to understand each one of them. Now let me understand, what do you mean by information? So if I want to highlight what is information, I would like to tell you a story. So it is written in B.P. Lathi's book. He is an Indian author, an amazing author of, you know, communication system. So how does he tell that what is an information? So let me just quote it this for you guys. So suppose a dog bites a man, right? A dog bites a man. It's a very generic thing, right? It has not much information. It is not going to be breaking news. Have you ever seen that a media channel or news channel is showing that a man is bitten by a dog? No, I don't think anybody would show this. I can be not be very sure that these days media channels are doing anything. So you never know, right? But generally, you just ask yourself that, will it be a news that if a dog bites a man, right? But if a man bites a dog, it is going to be breaking news. It is going to be all over the places. Right? That's how B.P. Lathi has defined information. Now let me come to the mathematical part of it. Why we said that when a man bites a dog is information? Because of the probability thing. So when I'll come in digital communication, then you will understand that why this scenario or this story or this example is so valid. A man bites a dog is having a very rare probability. I would say 0.005 or 0.1, means 10% chances that a man bites a dog. But 90% times it is going to happen that a mad dog can bite a man, and that has less probability. More probability means less information, and that will form the formula of information as well, which is log 2, you know, 1 by p. But log 2 p. So if you understand, we'll get you the formula later. But if you are trying to understand, information should be meaningful. If it is not, then it is noise. And we'll talk about noise at length, in detail. But if you ask me that, if I ask, any signal which is going into the channel is going to be affected by noise, correct or not, guys? Now tell me, what is the inherent nature of noise? Is it additive or multiplicative? Come on, ping your answers. So you have a very fair idea. Generally, noise will get added over the top of the signal, right? And that is going to be the challenging part of our, you know, being an engineer. Because you don't believe me, but when you say, right, hello to your friend, right, it actually goes through a lot of problem. So you're talking to your mom, you're staying out of your home, and you're talking to your mom, right? It is going to be, say, when you say like, okay, I'm doing this, and you're just doing some chit chat, but you think that it is just going directly to that side, it is not. And that's how being an engineer, electronics engineer, we are going to focus on these things. And it is going to be biggest challenge to minimize the noise and to improve the signal power to noise power ratio, which we call it as SNR. So that is going to be the real challenge of an electronics engineer. But that will come later, so you can relax for now. What are we going to do is, like, we'll start with very easy thing so that you get comfortable. I also get comfortable with the device, and then slowly we'll build over that. So that's the reason we teach digital communication after analog. Although nobody uses analog communication that much as we used to do. And let me tell you, after I think 1948, when transistor came into place and then IC came, I may be a little here and there in the years, but after that it is like non-stoppable. And very soon you will be seeing communicating to each other by using VR, virtual reality, and you will be seeing a person who is standing like a hologram thing you see in sci-fi movie, and people are just talking like with gesture and all. It's not like video call, but they are present in the room, but at the same time they are not present, you know, in the reality in that room. They are across the world, but they are able to come together. They can do client meetings, right? And they can just go away. If someone is working, they might be knowing that we use Skype like anything for our daily communication. So let me ask you a very simple question, and that will be the icebreaker. What do you think GeoSIM works on? What is the technology behind GeoSIM? The answer is VoIP, right? That is actually VoLTE. VoIP is full form is Voice Over Internet Protocol. So you are actually using internet to make calls, and that's why when Jio came into the picture, you need to have internet connection, right? Without that, you cannot make calls, and that is the recent technology, and you are using like anything. And trust me, Jio came with that idea, and I am myself witness to this, that when it came, before that we were paying like a lot of money, right? After that we are paying, I think everybody is paying some 300-400 bucks for a month. I used to pay like 1600 or 2000 rupees for a month. So that's how the things will change, and that's good for us, okay? And I hope you will be using this class as a building block, a basic platform where you can build your learning understanding, and when you go ahead, you can also contribute to these kind of revolutions. Now, if I start discussing this fact, now since, you know, before this, we were using, you know, normal 1G, if somebody remembers GPRS or Edge. Now we are using, you know, 4G, 5G is just coming in the picture. So that's how we are going one step ahead. But if you look at around your surrounding, we are using LAN networks, WAN networks, right? We are using GPS like anything. And thanks to GPS that a lot of companies are thriving, you know. I hope I can just name it Swiggy. So Swiggy is using Google-powered Google Maps, and that's just based on GPS. And GPS is part of our, you know, study, right? Communication guys. So GPS is changing the way we work. So you cannot just undermine this as a subject for your masters. This is an amazing, you know, subject. You can start with here, and I feel that I have given you enough motivation to go on this. So if somebody is still feeling that this subject is not worth it, just try to recall what I just said. Now guys, we'll start from the basic building block of communication system. Now, I want to take this, you know, this classroom as an example. Now, if you are talking to, let's say, 100-200 people in any room, any conference room, you must need to use a microphone and speaker and everything, right? So let's take that example. So what I want to do, I want to say, hello. I want to say hello to you guys, right? I want to say hello to you guys. But I want that you should listen as hello, right? That's what we want, right? I cannot shout like this every time because then I am gone. So I want to say hello, like very soft, in a very, very like low pitch sound. I want to say like hello, but I want to hear you guys like what? Hello. And that's the journey we want to do, right? So I want this small hello should come to you guys as a big hello. So we have to start from here. We have to start from here and we have to go there. Start, and that's the end. Now this is going to be very interesting, you know, discussion. I want to say hello, but I want to listen hello. Now, if you start thinking from like very beginning, then you will understand that how it is working. So when I say hello, what is happening? When I say hello, what is happening? So my vocal cord right here, and I think this is biologically done, so nothing to worry about. There we don't need to put any system in that, unless until we are fine. So when we say hello, right, so what is happening when I say hello? My each and every letter H-E-L-L-O is getting processed, getting coming out, right? And vocal cord is taking care of the correct pronunciation and everything, and then it comes out. So by the varying the pressure inside the vocal cord, right, we are trying to, you know, understand, we are trying to hear hello. But if I just give this hello, which is my voice signal, directly to the let's say any machine, right, it will not understand anything. And there comes Thomas Edison. You know Thomas Edison? So Thomas Edison was the person, right, he developed microphone. Right, guys? So when I say hello, and let's say this is my signal, so I'm going to say this is hello. So take like example, like this is hello. Just a very simple signal. Okay. Just a very simple signal. So this is hello. Now this is my voice signal, or you can also call it speech. It goes into a transducer. Then let me complete this block diagram, then I will make you understand what I'm trying to achieve. Then it goes into a modulator. Then it goes into an antenna. So this is my antenna, and we have transmitted this, right? Then we have received it here. It goes into a demodulator. And then again it goes into a transducer. Demodulator, transducer. And then we get this hello, and this hello is a very big signal. Let me draw here. So this hello has grown big like this. It is a big signal. Let me write here a small one, and it has been amplified, a big one. Now guys, pay attention. So when I say hello, so there is a microphone. Let me explain. I will come back and explain how does a microphone work. But microphone is a transducer here, guys. And what is the job of a transducer? You might have studied in engineering. Transducer takes one type of signal and convert into another type of signal. Here, I want that signal, voice signal, to get it converted into a voltage signal or current signal, or just say it like electrical signal. So here, I will get this signal as what? Electrical signal. Correct? As of now, it's my voice signal. Then it goes into modulator, and there are a lot of blocks are there. We'll come back and understand why do we need a modulator. But let's try to understand, when I am saying that I want to convey hello as hello, then what is happening in this classroom, right? So what is happening? I am sending a voice signal. Transducer is converting into an electrical signal so that we can amplify it. Modulator is going to take that signal and put it at higher frequency range. There's a reason for it. Modulator will take the signal and put it at a higher frequency range, and then it transmits to the channel. Okay. As of now, it is you can say a wireless channel, because we are going to use this most often time, but for study purpose you can think as a wired channel also. Then this is like transmitter side. So this is transmitter side. Guys, transmitter is also written as TX. That is the, you know, shorthand. And this is your receiver side. It is known as RX. Now this transmitter signal has been received here. Then again you need to put that signal from high frequency to low frequency. Yes? So that you can convert it back into your voice signal. But what is the role of this transducer? What is this transducer? This transducer is known as loudspeaker. So yes guys, loudspeaker is a transducer. And this transducer was microphone. Okay. So this is very high level building block of any communication system. I have discussed this irrespective of analog and digital for now. Although if you ask me what is this system, this is analog. But if you want to see what is digital and all, we'll have to wait for it. So guys, microphone is a transducer, loudspeaker is a transducer. Job of microphone is to take voice signal and convert into electrical signal. That's it. Job of loudspeaker is to take electrical signal and convert into voice signal. Why do we need that? If I just tell you that I am going to put you some voltage into your ear, what will you hear? You will hear only noise. Some zig-zig sound will come. You will not understand anything. Now, this stops here for communication system device. But how do you hear? Right? How do you hear? You hear by this biological device, and we call it as ear. Right? So, ear has three layers. Outer ear, this is outer ear. Then we have a middle ear. And inside that, we have an inner ear. So guys, obviously I'm not going to teach you biology, but outer ear job is to assemble or collect the coming signal. Middle ear, it has a liquid in that, right? It's a little viscous liquid, and it tries to do the impedance matching. So middle ear automatically try to, you know, cancel the noise and try to understand what is being said to you, right? And then you understand whatever it is, and it goes for the processing for the further, right? Suppose your brain will need that information to process it. So middle ear sends the processed thing to the inner ear, and so that inner ear can take it with the help of neurons to the brain, and brain understand that what is being said, and then you quickly respond. So it happens so quickly, but if you just put it in a very slow motion, then you understand that it takes a lot of, you know, system, devices, and the God's creation to just say hello, to hear hello, and that's how the whole journey is. Now if you don't hear anything or any of the device is not working fine, then you will have either noise, or you will not understand correctly, or you will misunderstand because you heard something else. Suppose your middle ear is having some problem. Sometimes people have hearing, you know, little hearing issues. So if you say somebody's hello, that person might hear buffalo, and then he can beat you, right? So the whole idea is to understand that communication system thrive only on one thing, that information should be conveyed in as it is formed with the highest possible quality. But when we say highest possible quality, it doesn't mean that you will put infinite bandwidth and infinite power, because bandwidth and power are quite correlated. You can just say that I will use 200 Gbps, right? But it takes a lot of money, a lot of infrastructure to get you that speed, and that is the reason it's costly. Okay, so whenever you think that any bandwidth is possible, any power is possible, always think of money, right? If you think of dollars, then you will never misunderstand the whole idea of bandwidth and power. These are two important considerations. Second thing is that always keep in mind, for any incoming signal, we always make sure that the signal bandwidth and power should be as low as possible. Having said that, for the channel, we say that the bandwidth of the channel should be as high as possible. Now, sometimes students, they confuse these two statements. The first statement I gave, it is for signal, right? That massive signal, okay? The second statement I gave, it was for channel, like we have our spectrum out there in the space or in the air, right? Wireless channel. Or you're using coaxial cable or optical fiber cable for that matter. So that channel bandwidth should be as high as possible. Signal bandwidth should be as low as possible to just accommodate a lot of signals into that. And that we call it in a fancy word, multiplexing. Yes or no, guys?